The goal? Make a Minecraft clone. The stipulation? Rely entirely on Godot and use very little math myself. I started off where most Minecraft clones finish, a three-dimensional loop that spawns in a bunch of static bodies with meshes and collisions. The problem is that normal meshes aren't all that performant, and I was killing my FPS before I could even get a good amount of blocks rendered in. Another more interesting problem is all the collision shape nodes. How can you justify having a collision shape 100 blocks away from the player, almost destined to never be used? I'll show you how I solved that problem later on, but first I want to look at Godot's multimesh node. Multimeshes are these weird things that can render one mesh over and over really efficiently. They're tricky to figure out and come with a lot of weird behaviors, including bugs, but they made rendering all these blocks much, much more efficient without me having to do any mesh adjustments myself. The max size of the multimesh is calculated with the width times height times depth of each chunk. Then each multimesh instance, or in other words, the visible block shown by the multimesh, can be given a transform, and that's where it shows up. If it's an empty transform, then it's invisible. So perhaps the 27th block in the multimesh is supposed to show at coordinates 3, 3, 3, so that's where we set its transform to be. The problem is that I'm calculating the size of the multimesh based on 3 dimensions, but the size value itself is a single linear number. So when I was trying to calculate which block needs to be rendered in, I was giving it a width, height, and depth parameters, like the 333 coordinates, but those needed to be converted into a single number, like 27. After a few hours with ChatGPT, I was able to get this formula. Using that formula, I could start checking specific blocks and whether they were actually rendered in or not. If they were invisible, then they didn't exist and it was an empty air block. If it was an empty air block, then the static body with a collision shape didn't actually have to be active there. Using that logic, I made 34 static bodies that follow the player everywhere, and they check each frame whether they should be valid or not. This means that instead of relying on thousands, potentially millions of static bodies, I can rely on just a few for the player collisions. I created a larger set of static bodies that checked for blocks, but this was for breaking and placing them. When hitting the break button, a raycast asks each static body that it hits if there is a block there. If so, it breaks it and ends the function. This way, even with 125 static bodies surrounding the player, only 5 are really checking if there are blocks there, at most. Placing blocks works the same way, except instead of breaking a block, it places a block just before it. So yes, this is all pretty inefficient, but instead of using math, I am using static bodies to do all the work for me, which is kinda like the main stipulation. Then I took a break from all of the heavy coding and added support for multiple chunks, 9 block types with a switching system, a title screen with a fancy animation, settings, and some trees and blocks maybe, a little music here and there, and some sound effects. In case you're wondering, the leaves were made from swishing my water bottle around, the breaking effect is from crushing a chip bag, the wood is from tapping my mic, the sand from clicking a pen, and just some other random stuff. This is where I was gonna end the project. It didn't really bother me that the world was flat, but then I saw videos like this and I realized I was not pioneering the Godot Minecraft clone space, so I had to step it up a bit. I learned how noise maps work, and then I used one to create a height map. If a block's X and Z position correlate to a Y value greater than what's on the height map, then no block is spawned at that Y level. Pretty simple once I got the hang of it. What killed me though was adding negative chunks. Before, I was spawning the player at 0,0 and all the chunks in the negative quadrants were gone. I decided to start rendering those in and it sucked. I'm not gonna over explain this because you'll either get it or you won't, but basically there is no such thing as -0. After about a day of figuring it out, this is the math that got it all to work. It's a shame that you can't rely on Godot to do all the math for you, but that's why computer science degrees hold value. With a full range of chunks to render, I made them render when you moved closer, and then de-render when you walk away. That was a pain, and it relies on the super, super inefficient code that is weighing the game down, but oh well, I don't really feel like explaining how this works. Anyways, this is where I ended it, but it doesn't mean the project is done. You can download the source code, which will be in the description, and you can tinker with whatever you want. Add more blocks, sound effects, refactor the code, study the code, whatever. It's open source now. Bye bye.